Welcome to Agape Love, Church of Jesus Christ, Easter Sunday. It's April 4th, 2021. And today we are talking about the setup for the resurrection of Israel. Right? I know today is in memory of Jesus Christ rising, resurrection from the cross, but it also represents, God has been speaking to me about the resurrection of Israel and how it's tightly knitted with Jesus Christ and the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the story of Jesus Christ and the prophecy, testimony, and teachings of Christ. Okay, so we're talking about the setup for the resurrection and how Christ is key to the entire thing coming together. We'll be going over the current condition of Israel as a people and as a nation. The plan for resurrection according to Scripture, part one and part two of the plan, I'll be talking about that out of Scripture. And this whole thing will be a process. The whole resurrection of Israel is going to be a process, both individually and collectively for Israel. So we'll be talking about that as well. And the process includes acceptance of God's plan, including Christ, the promises of redemption, and the power that will be yielded for these things to come to pass. So our first scripture will be Isaiah 1, 5 through 11. But first we're going to pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this word. Thank you for this day, Lord. Thank you for Jesus, Lord. Thank you for the teachings and the covering, Lord. Thank you for your direction, Lord. I ask that you fall fresh on us today, Lord. Let the living God, the Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on us today as I deliver this message, Lord. Let it be edifying to your children. Let it also be edifying to me, Lord. In Jesus' name, have your way, Lord. Speak through me. Let it be all of you and none of me. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so we are going through Isaiah 1, chapter 5 through 11. Okay, why should ye be stricken anymore? You will revert more and more. The whole head is sick and the whole heart faints. From the sole of the foot even unto the head, there is no soundness in it, but wounds and bruises and putrefying sores. They have not been closed, neither bound up, neither modified with ointment. Your country is desolate. Your children are burned with fire. Your land, strangers devour it in your presence, and it is desolate and overthrown by strangers. And the daughter of Zion is left as a cottage in a vineyard, and lodge in a garden of cucumbers, as a besieged city. Okay, I'm going to stop right there, because what we are talking about right now is the condition of Israel right now as a nation, as a people, where we are in the resurrection process, okay? So let's just go back. Why should ye be stricken anymore? So this is the calling, right? This is the condition of Israel, and it's also the calling of Israel to resurrection. We have to come out of the desolate places that we have been in all these years, right? So there was a plan for us to come out of it, and we'll talk about that as well. But in accepting of the plan and adhering to the plan and understanding the plan by the power of the Holy Spirit in executing our duties as Israel, we have to look at the condition of Israel, right? We have to know the condition of Israel so that we can move forward proactively in repairing it. So why should ye be stricken anymore? Ye will revolt more and more, right? So in our desolate place, in our struggle, we will continue to revolt against the systems that are in place unless we figure out another system, right? Another system according to the will of God. Unless we we come together in an understanding of Christ, right? Because why Christ is the way, the truth, and the light is because Christ is pure, right? And we have to move forward in purity for a nation that is full of love and kindness and restoration and prosperity and peace. So you will revolt more and more. The whole head is sick and the whole heart is faint, right? So we are tired. We are struggling, right, with the way things are because our heart is not really identifying with those things like the world thinks we should, right? Because it's coming to a point we are different. We are a blessed people, a peculiar people, right? So in that instance, if we know that we are the seeds of Abraham, we know there are some things that we can't take, we can't deal with, we can't grow from here. We have to repair, we have to resurrect, and we have to go through the process of resurrection to come into the understanding of Christ so that we can be unified under a universal understanding of Christ so that we are able to teach about Christ because Israel is to become a royal priesthood. Okay, so why should you be stricken anymore? Because we have the full prophecy of Christ that's coming into fruition. We have an understanding of the real Hebrews. We have an understanding of how things are working, right? So the understanding is coming by way of the Holy Spirit. So from the sole of the foot, even unto the head, there is no soundness in it. So the sole of the foot is the foundation in which we're walking, right? And to the head, Christ is to be our head. But because we do not have Christ, we are all over the place in regards to what Scripture is saying. If we apply Christ to our knowledge and our understanding of biblical Scripture, then everything will come into a clear understanding. That is the purpose of the New Testament, right? Not to do away with the Old Testament, but to bring the Old Testament into a complete understanding so that we can execute the duties of God spiritually versus physically. Because our flesh is weak, right? If we can't command our flesh, but our spirit can command our flesh. Our spirit can be transformed to transform our flesh, right? So from the sole of the foot even unto the head, there is no soundness in it. Sound wisdom. We need sound wisdom, something that can come together in the understanding of Christ and why things. And we'll be talking about Christ's teachings more this week. But the whole head is sick and the whole heart is faint. From the sole of their feet until there is no soundness in it, but wounds and bruises and putrefying sores. So we have wounds, right? We have wounds that have affected us over history that has caused us to have somewhat of PTSD in regards to religion, in regards to Christianity. So what we have to do is collectively come together to try to heal those wounds, try to get some understanding in regards to what went wrong and where we lack understanding in regards to Christ, right? So that's what Agape Love will be doing over the next couple of months. It's just gathering information in regards to how we feel about Christ because Christ is the way, the truth, and the light, and we have to move forward. Okay, so your country is desolate. Your cities are burned with fire, desolate, right? Our country, it's where we dwell. It's our existence, right? It's desolate because it's void of spirit, because we lack the understanding that we must go into the embodiment of the Holy Spirit to move forward in the promises of God. So because we are rejecting Christ, because we are rejecting the understanding of the Holy Spirit, we are becoming desolate, right? And your cities are burned with fire, your land strangers devoured in your presence, right? So in understanding, we have promised land, we have blessed land, we are created by God, we have something pending for us to collect on, but we are unable to do it because we cannot see together, in unity and in forward movement. We have been traumatized over time. So the condition of Israel is somewhat ill, right? Somewhat sick, somewhat in need of healing and in understanding. So, and the daughter of Zion is left as a cottage in a vineyard and lodge in a garden of cucumbers as a besieged city. So we have to look at the daughter of Zion. We have to look at women in regards to the nation of Israel, in regards to where our women is, in regards to their power, right? Because a lot of women aren't being respected, and they're not respecting themselves. And we need the women to come into their full divinity, right? So that we can help our men come into their kingship. Because without the spiritual counsel of a woman, men are locked into their logical understanding of things. And for the full understanding of the New Testament to come into fruition, there needs to be kingdom marriages in place, with the woman and a man and the feminine and masculine energy, right? So we have to repair that broken part of us that is rejecting each other in regards to kingdom marriages and kingdom unions, okay? So except the Lord of hosts had left unto us a very small remnant, we should have been as Sodom, and we should have been like unto Gomorrah, right? So that is Isaiah 1 and 9. And the small remnant that God has left with the prophets of the Bible, the small remnant that God has left is the prophets of the New Testament, right? And those and the believers of the New Testament have been spreading the gospel of Christ, right? We have been spreading the gospel of Christ, or before this generation, the gospel of Christ was spread, and it was our it was a place of healing. It's a place of recovery. It's a place of resurrection, a place of salvation that we have rested in throughout our culture and during the time of slavery and after, right, because of all of the trauma that has occurred throughout history. But now we are coming into a place where the narrative is being Christ is not key. Christ is it's idolatry and things like that. And we are coming to a place where it's either resurrection or death of Israel, right? So we have a choice. We have a choice to make. And Israel is being called to resurrection in the reflection, honor, and example of Christ this year and this day. So 10 says, hear the word of the Lord, ye rulers of Sodom, give ear unto the law of our God, the people, ye people of Gomorrah, right? So in this instance, they are being referred to as the rulers of Sodom and the people of Gomorrah, because the desolate and the trauma and the putrefying sores of Israel is oozing with the need to heal, to come forth as holy. We have a problem with holiness. We are not holy in our ways, in our thoughts, in our actions, right? So this is bringing about spiritual warfare unnecessarily, because we have the blueprint to move forward, but we are falling under the convincing narrative that Jesus is not the way, the truth, or the light, right? And we're also being caught up in things of the world that has really nothing to do with our salvation. One of the things that I learned in nursing school was that when we took the final exam, the final test, that we are to pay attention to the things in the question that will lead us to the answer, right? And I know that we have a lot of questions about scripture and a lot of things, but we are asking and we are thinking on a minuscule physical level, and we have to understand that God is a big God. He's a powerful God. So he is not limited to our physical existence or the physical attributes of our environment. So Israel is being called to resurrection and reflection, honor, and example of Christ this year, this day. There is no reason to continue to suffer. Christ has already died for our sins, right? And he has given us the blueprint for recovery. So there is no reason to continue to suffer. Christ has died for our sins. Grace has been given to us by the prophecy, crucifixion, and teachings of Jesus Christ from the beginning to the end. There has been a plan for resurrection. There has been clues and prophecy into the inside of not only how Israel will recover, but the blueprint for the resurrection was given to us by Jesus Christ. However, the world has desperately tried to cover it up, right? So, and I don't think that the world has desperately tried to cover up. Maybe, you know, but maybe we have to understand that Israel was partly in the dark, right? And until the fullness of the Gentiles come in, and that is in Scripture as well. So, there has been a plan for resurrection that has been clues and prophecy into the insight of not only how Israel will recover, but the blueprint for the resurrection was given to us by Jesus Christ. However, the world has desperately tried to cover it up, but the time is now for us to recognize what's going on, right? And what has happened and the power in which we are coming into our resurrection. The persecution and the crucifixion of Christ led to his resurrection. So we have to understand that the persecution, the things that we have suffered throughout history in regards to coming into the fullness of prophecy, will lead to our resurrection as a nation. But it has to be acknowledged for what it would be and why it would be. So Jesus knew that the purpose for his sacrifice was for the salvation of Israel, the salvation of the world, right? So in his going to the cross, in his carrying the cross, he was patient, he was obedient, he was knowing that there was glory on the other side. And that is a concept that we have to also come familiar with in regards to our own personal resurrection and our national resurrection and our resurrection as a people in general. So verse 11 says, "To what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices unto me, said the Lord? I am full of the burnt offerings of rams and the fat of the beast, and I delight not in the blood of bullocks or of lambs or of he-goats," right? And we know that goats is the representation of opportunity, and the goats are at the left hand of God, and the sheep is at the right hand of God. So what we are trying, what we need to do is bring souls to God through Christ, right? Because he is not going to respect offerings of the physical nature, offerings of the idolatry nature of men in regards to who they are. So we have to offer God from the works of our heart, right? So when we offer God from the works of our heart, we bring souls to God. We bring glory to God. We bring peace on earth. We bring provision to those who are in need. We bring grace and to those who are suffering from their own internal conviction, right? So we should have grace and mercy on our brothers and sisters to encourage them and uplift them versus trying to condemn them for a way of life, to give them hope and a future, okay? So our second scripture, we're going to talk, so that's the condition of Israel, right? That is the condition of Israel. So now we have to go to the plan. There is a plan for salvation, right? And it's spoken to us in scripture so much, but we have ignored it. We have not ignored it, but we haven't paid attention to it in regards to its importance. Okay, so we're going to go to Genesis 15, and we're going to read from 12 to 18. Okay, so this is Abraham's vision. This is Abraham's vision before his name was changed to Abraham. We have to understand that the name change of Abraham was directly related to the change in his life because of the blessing of God, right? So in that regard, we have to understand that Jacob's name was changed to Israel, right? And Judah is the son of Israel. So in the coming together of Israel and Judah, we will have a communion of children of God and the Father God in heaven. So, and also the commencement of the covenant that God had with our forefathers. Okay, so Genesis 15 and 12 reads, "And when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram. And lo, an horror of great darkness fell upon him, and said unto Abram, Know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. And also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterwards shall they come out with great substance. And thou shalt go to thy fathers in peace. Thou shalt be buried in a good old age. Okay, so this is the first part of the plan, right, in which we're talking about that God spoke to Abraham in regards to the redemption of the resurrection of the children of Israel. So we have to understand that the plan was spoken in Scripture from the beginning to the end, right? So in this part, Abram was receiving information from God in regards to how this will come about, because God promised that he would be a father of many nations, that his seed would be blessed. So in the explanation, God gave Abraham a vision, right? And the vision is, we talked about before, the vision of the heifer of 3 years old, and the she-goat and of 3 years old, and the ram of 3 years old, and the turtle dove and a young pigeon, right? So that was part of the vision that God gave Abraham in Genesis 15:9. And in that vision, we talked about the symbolism involved in that vision, the symbolism and the message of that vision, right? And I attributed the 3 years to the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. But recently I've come to the understanding that Jesus did his work for 3 years. So I think that's significant in the decision, the choices that we're making in regards to the resurrection of Christ, the understanding of Christ, and moving forward in Christ, right? So the 3 years can represent the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and it can also represent the 3 years in which Jesus did his work, in accepting his works, in learning his works, and moving forward in the understanding of his teachings. We will come forth in great substance, which was a promise to Abraham after the explanation of the affliction in a land that is not theirs for 400 years. So, and there's also a promise of redemption, and there is a promise of vengeance from the Lord. So that should also comfort us in regards to moving forward, that we don't have to do anything to seek vengeance on anybody or anyone who has done harm to us over the years, but that we should just move forward in purity and let God take care of everything. And that is a healing decision, like just a decision to focus on healing, not on vengeance, right? And when we focus on healing and we focus on coming into Christ and acquiring the Holy Spirit, then we can also get the answers to the questions we have in regards to how to move forward. Because God is speaking, the Spirit of God is available to us, but we have to be able to listen. And we can't listen with a hardened heart. We can't listen if our soul is petrifying sores and putrefying sores and all this stuff going on. We have to be able to listen to God in purity, because if we are not, if we don't know the character of God and we are not dwelling in the Spirit of Christ, then we won't understand the directions and the insight that is being given by the Holy Spirit. So there is no point. We must heal. We must move forward. Okay, so let's go to 15:13, and thou shalt go to thy fathers in peace and shall be buried in a good old age. So to go to thy fathers means to come into the fullness of your covenant, right? Because our fathers is Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, right? So we should go, and we should also our Father in heaven, which is God, right? So we will come into our God self. We will reconnect with God in regard to our spirit self and our relationship, both individually and nationally. Okay, but in the fourth generation, they shall come hither again, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet full. Right? So we have to understand that we have to trust the process. We have to trust the process in what God is bringing forth his prophecy in biblical scripture. But in trusting the process, we also have to accept Jesus Christ. Good evening, Sasha. How are you? Thank you for joining me. So we have to go forward in the process not rushing God, not being impatient with God, not trusting God, not getting weary in well-doing, but understanding that Christ and the full fruition, as we walk with God, as we walk with Christ, as we walk in purity of Christ, then the promises of God will come into fruition. So that's all we have to focus on. We don't have to focus on vengeance. We don't have to focus on, getting out of the system. We have to focus on creating a new system in Christ, right? Because that is our promise. And the direction for that will come by way of the Holy Spirit. Therefore, worshiping, prayer, journaling, all of these things is what needs to occur for individually for us to come into understanding for our individual selves, for our individual purpose. Okay, and 18 says, in the same day the Lord made a covenant with Abraham, with Abram, saying, unto thy seed have I given the land from the river of Egypt unto the great river, the river Euphrates, right? And so we have to look at that. We have to look at the land. We have to look at the blessed land that is available for us as a promise of God. And we have to kind of search that out, because in the coming of prophecy, in the coming of the fulfillment of prophecy, we must be prepared. We must be divinely directed and guided. Okay, so the substance of spiritual power, understanding, and understanding that transcends our current times, and understanding that will change the trajectory for our lives into the promises of God by the power of the Holy Spirit. That is what we're seeking through Christ. That is what we're seeking in purity, when we are good people, when we are doing the right thing, when we are treating people properly, when we have cleansed ourselves from the pain and the trauma of our past, then we can prove the perfect will of God. So that's why Scripture says, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you can prove the perfect, and, so that you can prove the perfect will of God, because we can only prove the perfect will of God in complete righteousness. Amen, amen. Okay, so the significance of the 3 years for Abraham's vision and how it relates to the Holy Trinity, and Jesus worked for 3 years. Genesis is the Old Testament. This is a direct correlation between the Old Testament and the New Testament that can only be pointed out and put together by the power of the Holy Spirit. So what I've come to realize is the Old Testament and the New Testament coincide together, but the New Testament is only understood by the power of the Holy Spirit. But once the Spirit of understanding come upon you, you can easily connect the dots between the Old Testament and the New Testament. But the reason why we are lacking understanding, direction, and the culmination of unity is because we are rejecting Christ. So until we start to observe Christ and teach and learn from Mark, Matthew, Luke, and John, and the time when Christ was here, then we will have we'll be struggling, we'll be fighting, we'll be arguing, and it's because none of that is Christ-like. If you are following Christ, you know that none of that is Christ-like. So that is why for the arguing and the fighting to stop, we have to come into a Christ conscious collectively, and we have to only tolerate Christ-like treatment of each other, right? When someone is treating someone that is not Christ-like, we have to come in between that, stop that, say something. So until we come into acceptance that what has happened throughout history was for us to come forth stronger and better, then we will repeat the same mistakes, because we are not completely trusting God. By adhering to the Old Testament and understanding, well, by accepting that the New Testament is a continuation of the Old Testament, then we are trusting God, right? But if we say that we're worried about the people and we're giving society way too much credit in regards to writing scripture, we can't say that people are writing scripture over, because the understanding that's given to us by the power of the Holy Spirit will make it clear that it's not, something that's plagiarized not to the extent to where we can't understand it. So let's go to Jeremiah part 2. So we're talking about part 2 of God's plan, right, for resurrection of Israel. So we're going to Jeremiah 1, 12 through 8. Then said the Lord unto me, thou hast well seen. So we're going, 18, Jeremiah 1, 12 through 18, and it reads, then said the Lord unto me, thou hast well seen, for I will hasten my my word to perform it, right? So God has given us a word of redemption, of salvation, of purity, of promise. So then said the Lord unto me, thou hast well seen, right? So like I talked about the power of the Holy Spirit and seeing what God has planned in the understanding and confirmation of the Holy Spirit. We have to pray about our scripture reading. We have to meditate after we read to come into full understanding, right? So I will hasten my word to perform it. When we come into fruition and understanding, when we seek and we find, then God can come in and perform the miracle, because we have to understand that God is not going to do something on our behalf if we're not expecting it, because he's going to get the glory, right? So if we are looking for the salvation of God, if we are looking for the power of God to manifest in our lives, then he will come forth, because we will then be able to glorify his name afterward. We need God to get the glory so that we can bring more souls to God. So then said, so 13 reads, and the word of the Lord came unto me the second time, saying, what seest thou? And I said, I see a seething pot, and the face thereof is toward the north. Then the Lord said unto me, out of the north an evil shall bring forth on all the inhabitants of the land. For lo, I will call the families. So let's talk about the vision that that Jeremiah had. So so God is, without trusting God, we are refusing to be brought out of darkness into his marvelous light. This walk will take faith, separate from our physical existence, a spiritual faith. Therefore, we have to tap into the sensitivity and vulnerability of our spirit in Christ, right? Because a lot of us are afraid to be pure. We're afraid to honor Christ in our ways because we feel like we might be taken advantage of. But God has promised his protection and his exalting of you in your Christ-like ways, right? So we have to understand, without worrying about the world or what the world is going to think, we still have to embody the spirit of Christ, right? And in trusting God, we will do that. In not trusting God, we will be captive to this world, thinking that we are in control and trying to control situations that are not meant for us to control, but observe. Okay, so in Jeremiah, the New Testament in its entirety, after the horror, the darkness, and the confusion mentioned in Genesis, right? We have to understand for confusion. What we have to understand is about confusion. For confusion and for the sake of obscurity to be effective, everyone has to be in the dark, right? Everyone has to be in the dark for the plan of God to come into full fruition, to be effective in its culmination. We all have to be in the dark, right? So we were in the dark. We're coming into the light. We're coming into his marvelous light, but we have to accept Christ to be able to do that. I'm like, it's kind of quiet. Let me put the music on, y'all. So after the horror, the darkness, we have to understand that for confusion, for the sake of obscurity to be effective, everyone has to be in the dark. Okay? And so here we are. And here is the understanding we must seek and accept in Jeremiah 1, 12 through 17. Okay, so, and the word of the Lord came unto me the second time, saying, what seest thou? So he said, I see a seething pot, and the face thereof is toward the north. So let's go to 11, because what I want to talk about is these visions that Jeremiah saw, right, when the God was asking him, what did he see? Moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Jeremiah, what seest thou? And I said, I see a rod and an almond tree, right? So that's what I want to talk about. I want to talk about the rod and the almond tree, right, and the meaning behind the vision that Jeremiah had of the rod and the almond tree. So the rod is a metal bar used to hold cemented walls together, a thing of discipline. The connectivity of the Old Testament and the New Testament is the structure that will bring prophecy together in one building and unite Israel as the church. Because Israel is the church, right? And we are to be wed with Christ in the coming together of the bridegroom, the whole situation, right? We are to be wed with Christ. In the wedding of Israel to Christ will come prophecy. So the almond tree, almond is an edible seed that is the actual seed used to grow the tree, right? So an almond seed is the seed used to, that's planted to grow an almond tree. So that brings in mind the tree of life, who we are, who God made us to be, and also the seed of Abraham, right? So the seed of Abraham being connected to the tree of life on earth in the salvation and the resurrection of Israel will be the salvation and the resurrection of the world, because Israel is a royal priesthood. So in turn, we all are children of God, and every human, a seed planted on earth. Human creation is a seed itself, right? So if we understand that all human beings were created by God, and they all have a spirit and a body, and they all have a purpose, then we will be kinder to each other, more patient with each other, and loving toward each other. So let's talk about the seething pot. Jeremiah said he saw a seething pot and a face toward the north. So we're going to talk about that. So the seething pot represents the tiredness of our ancestors, the readiness of what God has been cooking, right? So God has been cooking this plan for salvation, for redemption for a while now, and it's coming to a boiling point. It's coming to a point where it's about to boil over. It's done. We are here. It is already done. All we have to do is make a choice to understand and accept Christ, right, to be able to come into the power of the Holy Spirit that has been given to us as a gift from God. So the face towards the north, there is a distinct relationship between us, the north, and freedom, right, because most recently recorded during slavery, slaves went through to the north to get freedom, right? So this is prophetic, and then north represents freedom. The northern star represents freedom, right? So a face towards the north, meaning we are facing freedom, we are facing salvation, we are facing resurrection, but we have to come into the understanding of Christ. We have to. So we have the seething pot, we have God's plan coming into a fruition, we have the almond tree, we have the rod, we have all these things that Jeremiah is seeing in regards to what God is telling him about the future, right? About the future, that is the thing about prophecy. It will come to pass when it's time to come to pass. It doesn't matter what time is being spoken or when it's being spoken, because nothing is understandable at that time. Like, I know Jeremiah was like, what's going on here? But he still recorded what he saw. It was still recorded, and for a time such as this. Okay, so So we have to look at the 14. Then the Lord said unto me, out of the north an evil shall break forth upon all the inhabitants of Israel, right? So an evil. We are looking, sometimes we look for war and we look for these crazy things to happen. But an evil in scripture can just be a bad spirit, right? A spirit of inequity, a spirit of wrath, all the ways of the flesh in spiritual form, in spiritual warfare, and that is what we're fighting. We have to understand that we need to look at Galatians 5 in regards to the ways of the flesh, because that's what we're fighting up against, and the only way we can fight that effectively is through the fruit of the Spirit. So if we're having a problem with the elements of society, the only way we can change things is by being an example in a Christ-like spirit. So the connection between the north and freedom, but for the danger to be coming from the north, that means we must realize we cannot go back to the same way we came. We must fight this battle spiritually, right? We can't do the same thing we used to do. We can't. It's no marching in the streets. It's not the Civil Rights Act. This is a different time, right? And if the Holy Spirit is available for the taking, and we know spiritual warfare is here on earth, then we know that we have to fight this battle spiritually. We have to fight this war spiritually in prayer and supplication to the will of God, in the acceptance of Christ, in the holiness of a nation that was predestined by God. So it brings to mind the scripture, those who wait upon the Lord will mount up on eagle wings, will walk and not get tired, and will run and not faint, right? So let's go back to 15. For lo, I will call all the families of the kingdoms of the north, said the Lord, and they shall come, and they shall set every one to his throne at the entering of the gates of Jerusalem, and against all the walls thereof round about, and against all the cities of Judah. Okay. So we have to understand that we are talking about the second part of God's plan for the resurrection of Israel, right, out of Jeremiah, and we are in Jeremiah 1:12-17, and we just read 15. So I will call all the families out of the kingdoms of the north. So last week we were talking about the northern and the southern kingdom in regards to the northern kingdom being the kingdom of Christ, and the southern kingdom being a physical realm of existence that is kind of desolate, right? But in further research, I have come to realize that in scripture, the northern kingdom is Israel, and the southern kingdom is Judah, right? So in the northern kingdom is Israel. Israel is Jacob. Israel is our father, right? Our forefathers that we had a covenant with, or that God had a covenant with. And Judah is the son of Israel, right? So in the southern kingdom, what we are trying to do is bring the southern kingdom into the relationship of the northern kingdom so that prophecy can be fulfilled. So the Lord said unto, for lo, I will call all the families of the kingdom of the north. So the covenant holders, the covenant observers, the covenant, the people who have observed the covenant, who have sought the understanding by power of the Holy Spirit, who have done the work to come into fruition, those people will be sent to speak to Judah, right? And against all the cities of Judah. So they shall come, and they shall set every one his throne at the entering of the gates of Jerusalem, right? So the entering of the gates of Jerusalem. We have to know that Jerusalem is the place where Jesus Christ was crucified and resurrected, right? Jerusalem is holy ground. Jerusalem is the holiness that Israel needs to come into as a people to inherit the promises of God. So at the gates of Jerusalem, we are now at the gates of Jerusalem, at the entering of the holiness of Israel, right? So at this gate, we must take the responsibility upon ourselves to become holy, individually first, and then nationally. Okay, so let's go back to 16. And I will utter my judgments against them, touching all of their wickedness, who have forsaken me and have burned incense unto other gods and worshiped the works of their own hands. So these are the promises of God, plan one, plan two, part two, where, let's just sum up part two, right? So part one is the explanation to Abram in his vision, right? And part two is the explanation to Jeremiah in his vision, the seed and the rod and the seeding pot and the almond seed. Y'all, I got into it. I just let the ads run. So the almond seed, the seeding pot, and the face towards the north, right, and the rod of the connectivity between Israel and Christ, right, and the coming together of the church, and then the seething pot of the tiredness of our ancestors, of the cooking, the readiness of what God has been cooking in regards to prophecy, and our faith towards the north in regards to freedom, right? But also the understanding that we can't go the same way we came, right? That we have to fight this fight spiritually. So that is the understanding of part one and part two of the plan. So now we're going to talk about the process. The process in which we come into Christ, right? So the setup of the resurrection can be looked at like the 12-step program of an addiction program, because our attachment to our physical existence is somewhat of an addiction that we must trade in for real freedom, right? So when we're thinking about how to come into the understanding of our personal resurrection, we can look at the dynamics of the 12-step Alcoholic Anonymous program, and there's a direct correlation there. So if you guys have a pen and paper, I suggest you take notes, because we're going to go through each one of these steps, right? And then we're going to talk about the AA understanding, and we're going to talk about the spiritual understanding in Christ. But give me 1 second, you guys. I don't have the paper with me. Hold on 1 second. Okay, Liz, so we're talking about the Alcohol Anonymous, right, and how it correlates with the recovery from our carnal selves in regards to our resurrection in Christ, collectively, individually, and collectively. So one of the first steps in Alcoholics Anonymous is admitting that we are powerless over alcohol, that our lives have become unmanageable, right? So in regards to the first step of our walk with Christ in the resurrection of our spirit, we must admit that we are powerless. We must admit that we are powerless in this world, that there is a higher power looking out for us that we can turn to in regards to our resurrection, in regards to our healing, in regards to our serenity and peace of mind. So, the second step in Alcoholics Anonymous is they came to believe that a power greater then ourselves could restore us to sanity. So in one of the second step is coming into the belief system that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity, right? So in regards to our resurrection with Christ, we have to believe in a higher power that loves you and will direct you, and understanding God's character, who he is and how he sees you, right? We have to understand that God loves us and he sees us as a blessed child, a blessing to the world. He created us to be fruitful and multiply on earth in spirit and in truth, right? So we have to understand who we are in the eyes of God. Just like in Alcoholic Anonymous, the recovery process it requires to come to a belief system that a power greater than ourselves to restore us to sanity, right? Because there is trauma. There is so much trauma embedded in alcoholism and addiction. There is there's a seeking for something. There's a seeking for fulfillment there. That's why this correlation is so powerful. So let's go to the third step. The third step is made a decision to turn our will and our lives over to the care of God as we understood him, right? So coming into the understanding of God through your pursuit of understanding, through your prayer and worship and the reflection of your own life, because what you will find if you reflected on your own life that you weren't in control, that God had the will the whole time, that God had his hand on you the whole time. So we'll make a decision to turn over things to God, right? We, in our walk with Christ, in our resurrection of our spirit selves, we'll make a decision to turn things over to God, turn over everything, the pain, the hurt, the struggle, the confusion. We'll turn it over to God in knowing that he will bring the understanding that we need to go forward. And we'll turn it over to God in understanding that he will take care of the problem. We turn it over to God in understanding that everything that has happened to us over time was for us to come to a place of understanding, that everything that we have gone through will attribute to our future. That is the third process, right? So make a decision to turn things over to God. And we're directly correlating the 12-step process of recovery to the recovery of the resurrection of Israel, right? And this is both individually and nationally. So we have to adopt this understanding ourselves and also be able to teach it this way to others who are trying to come into the resurrection. Okay, so four is made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves. So in Alcoholics Anonymous, they have to make a searching and fearless moral inventory of themselves, right, to come into the sobriety or the this is the fourth process, this is the fourth step. So the fourth step in our resurrection of Christ, in our resurrection in Christ, right, because we have to know that we have to heal ourselves. We have to come into a God-like understanding, a Christ-like understanding to be able to move forward. So in the resurrection, we will search ourselves. We will do shadow work, and we will heal. Shadow work is just the process of looking back on your lives and realizing what has happened in your life to damage you, to make you bitter, to make you mad, to make you sad, right, to think less of yourself, to have low self-esteem, what hurts you, who hurts you, right? And in discovering that, in discovering, searching yourself, like in Alcoholics Anonymous, they made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves, right? So in searching yourself, you will also come into the forgiveness of yourself and others, because when you look back on it, you will realize that other people weren't always the entire problem, that sometimes you were the toxic person, and sometimes your misunderstanding and their misunderstanding led to a disagreement that sometimes we take as an attack on our moral selves, on our lives, like we make people our enemies when there was just a lack of understanding there. So we have to do that to become pure in heart. We have to be able to be empathetic and understanding to our brothers and sisters in Christ and to those who are outside of Christ as well, because salvation is for the all. And the same grace that God has given us in regards to our walk, in regards to the time that he has given us to recover and come forth as pure gold, we have to give other people that same grace, that same mercy, because when we do that, we're not judgy, right? And when we get too judgy, then we can't see the light, because we just want to condemn people, and that's not Christ's light. Christ is about grace and mercy and recovery and salvation, right? And we do have to protect our own spirits, right, in the process. And we'll talk about that in another step. But we do have to search ourselves, and we have to admit. So let's go to the fifth step. The fifth step is admitted to God, to ourselves, and to another human being the exact nature of our wrong, right? So this is repentance. This is repentance, and in the fifth step to our walk with Christ, we are admitting to God only, right? We're only admitting to God, but in the Alcoholic Anonymous, you have to admit to the people that you have wrong, right? Because this is the physical existence of our lives, right? But in the spiritual relationship that we are trying to build, in the spiritual resurrections of ourselves, we have to admit to God only. First yourself and then to God, and you will admit it to yourself in the step of the shadow work. Okay, so the sixth step is we're entirely ready to have God remove all these defects of character. So the sixth step in the resurrection in your spirit is your complete submission. Understand why you can see, heal, and repent and are forgiven, right? So we have to understand Christ for who he is. We have to understand God for who he is. Understand why we are even able to repent, why we are even able to see clearly, why we are even able to heal, right? And in that understanding, there will be an appreciation. And in that appreciation, there will be a honoring of God and an honoring of Christ and an understanding that will continue to grow. Okay, so let's go to the seventh step. The seventh step is humbly ask him to remove our shortcomings, right? In the 12 step Alcoholic Anonymous, the seventh step is to humbly ask God to remove our shortcomings, right? So in the step to the resurrection of Christ, the realization of the importance of humility, the killing of our flesh in regards to being self-centered, the realization that nothing is about you. This is important because we must move ourselves out of the way for the full understanding and embodiment of Christ, right? For us to embody the spirit of Christ, to move forward, we have to be humble. We have to humble ourselves, and we cannot exalt ourselves. We have to know that God has created us to be a blessing on earth, and that is it. Everything else is vanity, right? So humbly ask him to remove our shortcomings. So in our humility, our shortcomings will be removed. In humbling ourselves, because the biggest part of our downfall is our pride, okay? So the eighth step is made a list of persons we had harmed and became willing to make amends to them all, right? So this is the eighth step in Alcoholic Anonymous. So the eighth step in our walk with Christ, in our resurrection of our Christ-like spirit, the evaluation of those you have associated with or are associating with for the protection of your healing, and test spirit by reaching out in the newness of your Christ conscious, right? So as you are being transformed and you are being led by the Holy Spirit and you are encompassing a Christ conscious, and you are following the teachings of Christ, and you are adapting yourself to them, you also have to decipher and have spiritual discernment over who's going to be around you and why not, right? Because you have to protect yourself during your healing process. You have to make sure that you stay focused and that you are steadfast in regard to the fulfilling or the fulfillment of the promises of God on your life in regard to what he has to offer you. Because what we have to understand is that God's promises can come before the completion of everyone. Like, we can get, we can inherit the kingdom of God within ourselves before it comes to fruition in the physicality of it on earth, right? So that is the point of going through these steps to come into a Christ conscious. Okay, so nine, so we in our, so that God can expose and separate those people and the things that are not in alignment with your new man. You have to do an inventory of your surroundings. So in Alcoholics Anonymous, you will be making amends with people, right? In the resurrection, in your Christ resurrection, you will be evaluating your circle, right? Cutting away, let God take away those people who should not be following you on your journey. Not to say not to abandon them and not to, like, you know, act like, you know, you are better than them, but to help them, you have to heal. You can't really help them without healing, right? So 9 says, in Alcoholics Anonymous, 9 is may direct amends to such people wherever possible, except when to do so would injure them or others. So we understand in the 8th step, we were making a list, right, in Alcoholics Anonymous. And in the 8th step, we are making, in the resurrection, we are looking at our surroundings. We are evaluating. We're taking inventory of the people that we have associated with, because we have to disconnect to be able to continue to walk with Christ. So 9 says, on 9, on Alcoholics Anonymous, says, may direct amends to such people wherever possible. So 9 in our walk with Christ says to forgive others and forgive yourself through understanding that all things work for the good of those who love the Lord. So in asking for forgiveness, we must forgive ourselves and others, right? And that we reference the Lord's Prayer in regards to that. And the Lord's Prayer is something that we should recite daily in the beginning of our walk with Christ, in the beginning of our efforts toward restoration and resurrection. So 10 says, for Alcoholics Anonymous, continue to take personal inventory, and we, when we were wrong, promptly admitted it. So in 10, the 10th step in our walk with Christ, I'm sorry, guys, this is kind of long, but it's a good sermon. So continue repentance and the awareness of your fleshly shortcomings. This will create ongoing growth and renewal, cultivating a stronger relationship with God and your spirit self, right? So through our constant repentance and the awareness of our fleshly shortcomings, we can monitor ourselves more closely and make the best decisions in regards to the fruits of the spirit and not the ways of the flesh. We have to check ourselves. We have to monitor ourselves and make sure that we're not doing anything outside of the will of God, because we will be reprimanded for going outside of the will of God, especially when we have committed our lives to Christ. So the conviction of our spirit will be prominent in our walk with Christ. So we have to continue to repent and be aware of our fleshly shortcomings. This will create ongoing growth and renewal, cultivating a strong relationship with God and your spirit self. So the step 11, we almost said step 11 is 11 in Alcoholics Anonymous is sought through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God as we understood him, praying only for knowledge of his will for us and the power to carry that out. And I don't even really have to go to the Christ way of doing this, because this is actually what we should be doing in Christ as well. We should continue, we should seek God through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God by the cultivating of an environment that is conducive to the Holy Spirit. We will become more familiar with God. So developing routine spiritual tasks to cultivate familiarity with the Holy Spirit, as the Holy Spirit will be your only dependable guide in your new life with Christ, right? Because that is what we use to guide us, to give us discernment, to give us spiritual messages, to give us direction, is the Holy Spirit. So the 12th step, finally, guys, is 12th step. Having had a spiritual awakening as a result of these steps, we try to carry this message to alcoholics and to practice these principles in all our affairs, right? So in your last step, in your Christ conscious, in your resurrection, we have a responsibility. So the same way alcoholics have this new awareness of life and become sponsors for other alcoholics, We must also help others who are in Christ or need the salvation or knowledge of Christ, because our healing, our renewal, and resurrection is not only for us, but so that we can glorify God and bring more souls to God. That is the reason for our resurrection. So in our 12 steps, in regards to Alcoholics Anonymous and our resurrection and our redemptive, and the reason why the 12-step Alcoholics Anonymous program is similar to the process in which Israel needs to come into Christ is because our addiction is to our carnal self. Our addiction is to our limited understanding in our carnal selves, and not by way of understanding by the power of the Holy Spirit. So we have to resurrect from that understanding. We have to come into and it's a process. It's hard. It's not easy to come into full understanding of the power of God, right? It's something that requires sacrifice and requires patience and requires faith, a lot of faith. So we take these steps and we keep them in our hearts. We follow our healing process in an effort to remember what occurred for a testimony and a guiding light to others. Loving others and knowing God, removing ourselves, and having Christ as our head always. Whew. So guys, this week we were talking about the Passover, we were talking about Palm Sunday, and now we're in Easter, right? So in the connectivity of our understanding, we see Passover as a reflection of the will of God on our lives. We see Palm Sunday as honoring the will of God on our lives, or honoring Christ, right? This is all about Christ, right? So Passover, the reflection of the will of God on our lives. Palm Sunday, the honoring of Christ, and Easter Sunday, the celebration of the resurrection. But we are also coming into a different understanding on this Easter in regard to the resurrection of Israel, right? So we talked about the plan, which was in Abraham's vision and his covenant, right? The plan, and then we talked about the vision that Jeremiah had in regards to the coming together of the plan, the part two of the plan, and the acceptance. Now let's go to Ephesians 2:2-8. Okay, wherein in time past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, right? So the power of the spirit of the air, the acceptance, we have to accept the condition of Israel. We have to accept the direction that God has given to us. We have to accept that it's time to change. It's time to move forward. It's time to come into fruition and the fullness of prophecy. It's time for freedom, right? We have to understand that it's time for freedom. So wherein in time past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. We have to disconnect from that spirit, right? So we have to look at the steps that we come into our resurrection, into the fulfilling of prophecy, into the freedom that God has promised us through Christ Jesus. So the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now, okay, so three reads, among whom also we all had our conversations in times past in the lust of our flesh. So we have to understand that we are not perfect. We are all human beings coming into the full understanding of God, pursuing righteousness with every fiber of our being. So the same grace that God has given us in the process, we are to give others. So the condemnation of the Old Testament has to be done away with, because the grace has been given, not saying that it is okay to walk against the laws of God, the laws of Moses. But we have to understand that the coming into the full obedience of the laws requires spiritual renewal versus physical condemnation, because of this is a new era, this is a new time, these are new promises, this is power, right? This is power by the power of the Holy Spirit versus trying to fight against flesh and blood. We now have the ability to fight against power and principalities in high places by the Holy Spirit. Okay, so we walked among whom also we all had our conversation in times past in the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, giving as even as others, right? So the children of wrath. Oh, so the children of wrath, we got angry for a minute. We was upset for a minute, right? And then we also have our brothers and sisters and another, you know, area that got upset too. But now it's time for peace. Now it's time for unity. Now it's time for understanding. Now it's time for the Lord to get his vengeance. And now it's time for the promises of freedom and redemption to come about. So, but God, who is rich in mercy for his grace, love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, has quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are saved, right? So this is what I'm talking about in regards to the grace of Christ and how Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. In regards to the recovery of Israel, we have to come into that understanding. We have to just accept it and move forward, because as long as we're fighting against it, we're going to be in the dark. We're going to be in confusion. And God is trying to take us out of the darkness into his marvelous light. But we can't see the light unless we accept Christ. So, hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, right? So we are to come together and sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus in holiness, in understanding, in unity, and these are heavenly places, right? That in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. So God's promises and the resurrection of Israel and the coming into fulfilling of prophecy is heavily rooted in the acceptance of Christ. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, right? So the gift of God is Christ Jesus. The gift of God is the grace and mercy that he had devised as a plan to resurrect us. That is the gift of God, and we need to accept that gift by accepting Christ into our hearts as our Lord and Savior. Okay, so that is Ephesians 2:2-8. And so we're talking about the plan 1 and 2, the acceptance, right? And this is Ephesians 2 just spoke about the acceptance, right? The acceptance is a part of the process. So we talked about the process in regards to Alcoholics Anonymous. Now we're talking in the acceptance in Ephesians 2:2-8. So now we're talking about the promise, right? And all of this is put together in the voice of reason of biblical prophets like Jeremiah and Ezekiel. So I encourage you guys to read that. So let's go to Ezekiel 4:16-17. Moreover, he said unto me, Son of man, behold, I will break the staff of bread in Jerusalem, and they shall eat bread by weight and with care, and they shall drink water by measure and with astonishment, that they may want bread and water and be astonished, asinine one with another, and consume away for each other iniquity, right? So to consume away iniquity, God is going to break the staff of bread, right? And the staff, the way the plan will come about, this is what Ezekiel was talking about. So the staff represents the power of God available to us, right? The staff of bread. The staff, we know that bread is the food of life, of manna from heaven. It was given to us in Scripture, the bread of life, right? And so the discipline of Scripture will be broken into understanding, right? So breaking it into pieces is dividing it. We know how Jesus fed a lot of people with the bread and the fish, right? So it will be broken. This is the promises I will break the staff of bread in Jerusalem, in the holy place, right? In the holiness of our existence, the staff will be broken. And they shall eat bread by weight, right? So the Spirit of God, the understanding of God, the heaviness of God shall be given to us by weight and measured out to us, right, in spirit, because we can't be all-knowing. Only God is all-knowing, so he's going to go ahead of us and make our crooked path straight, right? He is going to do things and put things in place that is going to aid us in our resurrection, in our turning back to righteousness. So that they may want bread and water and be asinine one with another and consume away their inequity, right? So when we are astonished by the understanding of Scripture, by the power of the Holy Spirit through the acceptance of Christ in our heart as our Lord and Savior, we will be not only be astonished ourselves, but also astonished with one another, which is the importance and significance of fellowshipping. Okay, so that is the plan and the promise and the acceptance and just the whole complete process of the resurrection of Israel and to come into that understanding. Let me make sure we went through all of it. Jeremiah, yes, we went through everything. So I just want to say that this church was a vision and an assignment given to me by God, and I am a humble servant and a blessed child of God. This church will be divinely guided by God through the power of the Holy Spirit, and all that will be accomplished through Agape Love Ministries will be all for the glory and honor of God. In Jesus' name, amen. So we are closing. But before we do, I want to encourage you guys, recommend to you guys that you accept Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior this day, because so that we can move forward victoriously in the promises of God, really, right, collectively, but also so that you can be free, so that you can be whole, so that you can have peace, so that you can move forward in confidence and faith that God is watching over you, so that you can accomplish all your dreams and manifest your true self here on earth while you're here. So we're going to pray.
Thank you,
Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God, so much for this service. Thank you for this message, Lord. I ask that this message be edifying and it falls on the ears and the hearts of those who might come under the sound of my voice. Lord, those who have come across this video, I ask that it's a blessing and eye-opening and spiritual renewal and awakening come from this message, Lord. Lord, let your power fall. Let your power move, Lord. Let this message be edifying to all those who hear it, Lord. I know that I am nothing without you, Lord. I cannot do anything without you, Lord, and we cannot do anything without you, Lord. We are accepting Christ as our Lord and Savior today, as our head, as our direction into the salvation of the Lord, into the promises of God. Lord, thank you so much, Lord. I ask that you continue to use me, continue to bless those that are under the sound of my voice, continue to bless the endeavors of this church, as it will glorify you, Lord, in everything, all the time. Hi, bud. I was trying to say, I hope you guys caught most of it. So, dear Heavenly Father, I ask that you touch those who are under the sound of my voice, Lord, touch their hearts, put Christ into this thing is tripping. So,
right where you are, somebody lift up the name of Jesus. Come on, call
it. I want you guys to enjoy the worship music.
How would you act?
And then thank you. I love you guys. I'll see you tomorrow. Be blessed in Jesus' name.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Come on, call it.